really this book verse by verse. Amen. We're doing that so that we all get a clear understanding of what the scripture is saying. Amen. Bible says that we need to hear what the Lord has to say. Amen. I pray that y'all have been getting as much out of this Bible study as I have. I have been learning things along the way. Amen. And then refreshing my mind. So I just give the Lord praise for that. But I do believe this, that there are many times we just have a habit of reading over the scripture just to say, God, I read a chapter, I read two chapters today, and just to kind of soothe our conscience. But the Bible says that we are to study, amen, to show ourselves approved, amen. So I'll tell you, that's why we're going verse by verse. How will we get a good study and a good understanding of what God has to say? 2 Timothy 2:15 says, study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. My goal in this Bible study and the goal of the Holy Spirit is that you and I would be able to say, I understand who I am in Christ. I understand what God requires of me. Can you say amen? So let's go ahead and open up this word in just a time of prayer real quick. Heavenly Father, we just come to you once again in the name of your precious Son, Jesus Christ. We are here tonight, God, not to learn from some book somewhere, the latest fad or this and that. No, 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 God. We're here to learn of your word tonight, God. We thank you for the book of 1 John, Lord, and all that it has for us. And I thank you, Lord God, that you put it upon John's heart to record the things that you spoke to them disciples about. God, I ask you tonight, God, that we would be hearers of the word, God, and not only hearers, but doers of the word, God. I pray over our minds, Lord, that we'll be able to comprehend what you're saying. Anoint me to teach tonight. God, give us minds able to understand, hearts ready to receive, ears able to hear, Lord God. I pray against distraction from the inside to the outside, that this study, that this message would not be hindered tonight. Anoint me and help me, Lord, to teach your word. We give you the praise in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen and amen. Hallelujah. Amen. 1 John chapter number 2. Well, let's read the first. Let's read verses 7, 8, and 9, because all three of these verses really are joined together, if you will. So let's start out reading these three verses, 7, 8, 9. 1 John chapter 2, verse number 7, brethren. Remember, who's this letter to? It's to the brethren. Amen. Brothers and sisters in the Lord. It's not written to the world. It's written to the saint. Amen. To help us, to edify us. Brethren, I write no new commandment unto you, but an old commandment which ye have heard from the beginning. The old commandment is the word which ye have heard from the beginning. Verse number 8. Again, a new commandment I write unto you, which thing is true in him and in you, because the darkness is past, and the true light now shineth. Amen. He that saith, he is in the light, and hateth his brother, is in darkness even until now. Amen. In verse number 7, John said, I'm not writing anything new unto you, but I'm reminding you of what God has said to you and I from the beginning. What is it that he's talking about? Leviticus 19:18 says this, thou shalt not avenge, amen, nor bear any grudge against the children of thy people, but thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. I am the Lord, God said, hallelujah. Jesus said in John chapter 13:34-35, a new commandment I give unto you, that ye love one another as I have loved you. Can you imagine that? That's what God said. We are to love one another as God loved us. Amen. I want to just know we need to be more patient with one another. Amen. More forgiving with one another. We are to love as Christ loved us. Amen. Again, verse number Verse number 34 of John 13. A new commandment I give unto you, that ye love one another as I have loved you, that ye also love one another. By this shall all men know that ye are my disciples, if ye have love one towards another. Amen. One to another. Whenever a believing sinner accepts Jesus Christ into their heart and into their life, there is an immediate definite change that takes place. Can you say amen? If there is no change that takes place in that individual's hearts, all they did is come down and weep a little bit. All they did was repeat a couple of words. But words don't save you. It's your faith in them words. Can you say amen? It's your faith in the words that you said, Jesus, I'm sorry for my sin. Come into my heart and make me new. Can you say amen? Oh yes, whenever a believing sinner asks the Lord to come into their heart to wash their sins away, oh, immediately that person is changed. They are translated at that moment from darkness into light. That's why the born again experience is the greatest miracle that could ever take place in a life. It's greater than blinded eyes being open. It's greater than the dead being raised. It's greater than anything you can imagine. When a sinner gets right with God, that is the greatest miracle that could ever take place. Can you say amen? But listen, if we say that we have been born again and yet we hate our brother, the word of God says that we are still in darkness. Amen. If you come down and say the sinner's prayer, if you will, and you get up and there's still hatred in your heart for other individual, you're still in the darkness like you were before. I've seen many of people come and weep all down here in the altar. They pray, trying to pray off conviction, if you will, but they never really repented. Oh yes, I'm here to tell you, when they got up the same way they came down. They may have felt a little bit better after talking to God a little bit, but there was no change within the heart. And John said, if you come down and you ask the Lord to come in your heart, just kind of paraphrasing, if you will, if you say that you've been saved and yet you still live in darkness and you still hate your brother, you ain't changed one bit. Can you say amen? I've known people who claim to be saved, but their hatred towards the brethren proved all along that they were still walking in darkness. Amen. We can say we're walking in the light all we want. Oh yeah, I know pastors that have said they're walking in the light. I know laity saying they're walking in the light, but their actions prove they were still walking in darkness. Can you say amen? If we refuse to fellowship with another believer because we don't see things eye to eye with them, we're still in darkness. Amen. Listen now, if we refuse to acknowledge people, even shake their hand, Remember verse number 9 again. He that saith that he is in the light and hateth his brother is in darkness even until now. Amen. Let's move on to verse number 10. 1 John 2 and 10. He that loveth his brother abideth in the light. Amen. Are you abiding in the light tonight? Amen. He that loveth his brother abideth in the light, and there is no occasion of stumbling in here. If we needed anything in this chapter, it is this verse right here. Amen. Listen. Amen. He that loveth his brother abideth in the light, and there is none occasion of stumbling in him. Have you ever heard of someone who's been church hurt?
Yeah.
Huh? Yeah, we all have. You ever been church hurt? Amen. I think we all have at a time or two. Sometimes I've been pastor hurt. Amen. Oh, yes, church. I'm telling you. Oh, it should never happen, but it does. We're human. Everybody's got faults. Everybody's got problems. Amen. And we're just living together. But oh, I'm telling you, though. I remember, let me just share this with you. There was a time whenever I met Miranda, we had gotten married like a month later. You ever hear of love at first sight? Amen. I believe in that. Amen. First time I saw her, I loved her. Amen. I proposed to her the second day I met her. Amen. Hallelujah. I don't recommend that at all. Amen. But God was gracious. Amen. And he helped us. Amen. But I remember there was a man that a friend of mine at church, he came up to me and he said, hey, Brother William, are you and Miranda expecting a baby? And I thought, what are you talking about? Are we expecting a baby? He said, yeah, Brother so-and-so said that you had gotten Miranda pregnant, and that's why you married her so quick. And that's why y'all got married. Oh, you see, many a people would have let that little rib destroy them. Amen. Many a people would have got upset at that church and left. And they'd have bad-mouthed it on the way out. Amen. Oh, I could have let that silly rumor affect me. I could have got upset, uprooted myself and my new wife out of the church. Amen. But you see, I abode in the light, and there was no occasion of stumbling within me. Can you say amen? Why couldn't that thing trip me up in my walk with God? It's because I abode in the light of Jesus Christ. And John said that if we have love for each other, then we are abiding in the light. How do you know that you're abiding in the light? How do you know you're living in the light? And you will, whenever somebody can offend you and it don't make you want to quit the church. Can you say amen? Whenever somebody can say something about you and you don't leave getting bad mouthed everybody else around. Amen. I'm telling you, that's why the Bible says that God will keep them in perfect peace whose mind is stayed upon the Lord. I believe we've got far too many crybabies in the modern day church world and not enough mature men and women of God. Oh, I tell you, how do you get mature? You've got to abide in the light. If you'll do that, there's no occasion of stumbling within you. Can you say amen? Oh, yes. When we're living in the light, our brother or our sister can't make us stumble. They may aggravate us. Amen. You ever been aggravated before? Oh, you ever had your toes stepped on before? Amen. Oh, yeah, Sister Diane says sometimes, well, I should have worn my steel toe shoes. Amen. You stepped all over my toe. But it doesn't make her hate me. No, no, no. Why? She's abiding in the light. Amen. Oh, yes, church. I've had people tell me that they didn't think I was much of a pastor. And the truth is, I didn't think they were much of a church member. Amen. Oh, but I'm telling you, I never let them stop me. Never let them make me want to quit. Why? Because I am born in the light of Jesus. Can you lift your hand up under the Lord tonight and say, Lord, let me get to the place where I'm praying, I'm studying, I'm seeking you with all that I have. I'm abiding in the light. Therefore, I won't stumble. Offenses are going to come. Oh, yes, they are. Sometimes you just ain't going to see eye to eye. You'll have disagreements over little things, and that's okay. So that's okay. We're human, but you can't let those little things turn into big things. Can you say amen? Amen. Many churches are destroyed because people ain't abiding in the light. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. We've got to abide in the light. Amen. So whenever Sister Lena, I'm just playing. Whenever Brother Wayne says something to me, amen, and it hurts me, I don't go, just start crying and breaking down. Oh, I want to go somewhere else. Oh, I'm just so broken about it. No, no, no. If we're abiding in the light, like Sister Lena and Wayne do, amen. If we're abiding in the light, though, you know what I'm saying? If we're abiding in the light, we ain't going to have to worry about falling out with God. He that loveth his brother abideth in light. Amen. I love my father with all my heart, but that doesn't mean we're never going to have a disagreement. Amen. He that loveth his brother abideth in light, and there is none occasion of stumbling within him. Amen. You want to be protected from church hurt? Amen. Abide in the light. Amen. And God will protect you. Amen. Let's move on to verse number 11 now. 1 John 2:11, but he that hateth his brother is in darkness, amen, and walketh in darkness, and knoweth not whither he goeth, because that darkness has blinded his eyes, amen. Those who walk in darkness are blinded to the fact that they are not even saved. Amen. Oh yes, I've met people like that. They were religious. Yes, they were. But they weren't saved any more than the man shooting heroin in his veins. They were just as lost spiritually as that man was. Amen. I knew of an individual who had some terrible things happen to him, and he allowed himself to become very, very bitter. His bitterness gave root to hatred, and before long it destroyed and consumed his life. I used to look at this man in church, and it's not here, amen. I used to look at this man sitting in church with the most cold-hearted, hateful look on his face, and I wondered to myself, how on earth can this brother act like that? How on earth can you refuse to shake someone's hand? How on earth can you refuse to acknowledge that brother or sister? I'm telling you, this young man would come into church. People be standing at the door ready to say, God bless you, how you doing? He, people have their hands out. He walk right by it, act like he don't even see you or hear you. Wouldn't acknowledge you at all. How can somebody do such an act? How can somebody refuse to be friendly, if you will, and be so hateful? Well, verse number 11 gives us the answer. But he that hateth his brother is in darkness, and walketh in darkness, and knoweth not whither he goeth, because that darkness has blinded his eye. He thought he was the most righteous, holy individual, but he didn't even realize he was spiritually blind. I'm here to tell you, if you hate your brother, you hate your sister, you are blind. Amen. Oh yes. Those who walk in darkness are blinded by the fact that they're not even saved. It's sad when you got to tell people, they may be even sincere, but you got to tell them, brother, you say you're saved all you want, but you're shacking up with your girlfriend. You say you're saved all you want, but you drink beer. You say you're saved all you want, but you go around, you cuss like a sailor. You ain't faithful to God. You ain't faithful to your wife. Oh, I'm telling you, many of people that can do those things and say they're saved, they're spiritually blind. They're walking in darkness. There's only one hope for somebody. Those who walk in darkness are blinded to the fact that they're not even saved. Verse number 12 now. In verse number 12, we've dealt a lot now with how we are to act. Amen. About not walking in darkness, not walking in hatred, and fellowshipping, and having love one towards another. I like verse number 12 here. In verse number 12, John now shifts his attention upon true believers who are walking in the light. Amen. How do you know somebody's a true believer? They're walking in the light. Amen. Hallelujah. They follow Christ's commandments. 1 John 2 and 12. I write unto you, little children, because your sins are forgiven you for His name's sake. Amen. Can you lift your hands up unto the Lord tonight? Say, thank you, Jesus, for saving my soul. Amen. Oh, aren't you glad that your sins have been forgiven? They weren't forgiven by my name. They weren't forgiven by Sister Diane's name or Sister Jessie's name or Sister Miranda's name. No, no, no. My sins were forgiven because of the name of Jesus. Amen. Oh, that's why the Bible says in Romans 10:13, for whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord, amen, shall be saved. Amen. The angel said in Matthew 1:21, and she shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins. Amen. We've been saved because of who Jesus was and what Jesus did at the cross. Can you say amen? Because of Jesus, you and I have been forgiven, and because we've been forgiven, we don't walk in darkness anymore, but we continue day by day walking in the light of Jesus Christ. Jesus said, I am the light of the world. Hallelujah. We've got to walk with Jesus if we want to walk in light. Can you say amen? We are saved for His name's sake. No other name given among men whereby we must be saved. Oh, but by the name of Jesus. Amen. If we say, if we walk in with God, we've been forgiven of our sins, and we're walking with the Lord. We are walking in His light. Remember, I write unto you, little children, because your sins are forgiven you. Amen. For His name's sake, I believe many people have trouble with just accepting the fact that their sins have been forgiven. Amen. They may have went down to an altar, and they get up, they're saved, they love God, but man, there's just something about them. They're just holding on to all the terrible things they used to do, and they can never move past that. But God says unto us tonight, I'm writing unto you, I'm talking to you tonight, because your sins are forgiven. You have been washed in the blood. You're walking in the light. Don't let the devil just trick you and lie to you and tell you that your past sins and your past failure, oh, your God, that God has done with you or can't use you anymore. No, no, no. God has washed you. God has cleansed you. God has forgiven you. So you just keep on walking in the light. Resist the devil. The Bible says, submit yourself therefore unto God. Resist the devil and he will flee. It doesn't mean if you resist, the devil's going to flee right there. You just keep on resisting him. Satan, get behind me. Ain't going to listen to your lie. I've been forgiven. I've been washed in the blood of Jesus. I'm a new man. I'm a new woman in Christ Jesus. All things are passed away. All things are become new. I'm not in darkness. I'm in the light. Amen. Amen. Verse number 13 and 14. Let's read these. These kind of go together too. 1 John chapter 2, verses 13 through 14. I write unto you, fathers, because ye have known him that is from the beginning. Amen. I write unto you, young men, because ye have overcome the wicked one. And I write unto you, little children, because ye have known the Father. What's he mean, the Father? He's talking about fathers in faith. Amen. Oh, I'm thankful that I've got many, many fathers in the faith. Amen. What is a father in the faith? It's an individual that is, it's somebody that's walked with Jesus for a long period of time, and they're able to help another believer, if that makes sense. So I'm reminded of my father, amen, my dad, amen. He wasn't only my daddy, he was my pastor. Sometimes I didn't really like that when I was younger, but oh, I tell you, there are times that I can look at his life and I can see, as a spiritual father, I can see this is the way I need to handle this situation. Amen. Oh, I can look at many other men of God. And I was listening to Brother David Wilkerson today, listen to a message that he preached. And I consider him one of my spiritual fathers. Never had the pleasure of meeting that great man. Oh, but his messages and books and teachings, oh, they ministered to me and helped me in my walk with God. And oh, I'll tell you, thank God for fathers and mothers in the faith. Amen. Verse 14, I have written unto you, Father, because ye have known him that is from the beginning. I have written unto you, young men, because ye are strong, and the word of God abideth in you, and ye have overcome the wicked one. Amen. Now, John mentions that his letter is not just for certain saints, but it is for all saints. Amen. John now mentions that his letter has been written for every stage of the believer's life, to the babes in Christ, to the teenagers in Christ, to the young adults in Christ, to the old people in Christ. It's been written for all of us. Amen. And John said, from the youngest to the eldest, apply this letter. We can apply this epistle to our life. Even a child, understand that if they are walking with Jesus, they can't walk in darkness at the same time. Even a child, understand, or a newborn Christian, know, if I'm really a child of God, I'm going to treat my brothers and sisters in a godly, loving manner. Can you say amen? John is also stating that these next passages of Scripture must be taught as well. Verse number 15, 1 John 2:15. Love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. If any man love the world, the love of the Father is not in him. Amen. John lets his readers know, don't fall in love with the world. The world is not a globe. Amen. The world's not a globe. It's not a map. It's not just a generic term. No, no, no. But the world is the system of the devil. Amen. The world is the system of the devil. Paul let us know that Satan is the god of this world. 2 Corinthians 4:4. In whom the god of this world hath blinded the minds of them which believe not, lest the light of the glorious gospel of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine unto them. John was saying, if we say that we love God, that we will not love this world. John said, if we love this world, if we love this world's system, if you will, then the love of the Father is not in us. Amen. I'll tell you, I love being alive. Amen. I love being alive. Everybody wants to go to heaven, don't we? Nobody wants to die. Amen. I ain't looking forward to die. I'm looking forward to being with God, though. Amen. Oh, but I'm telling while I'm traveling through this world, it is a temporal place. I am not to fall in love with it. Amen. How on earth could quote-unquote Christian before abortion, they have fell in love with the god of this world, and they don't even know it. How can quote-unquote Christian endorse homosexuality? They have fallen in love with this world's system, this world's laws. Amen. And they don't have to worry. They love this world. They're going to stay in this world when Jesus comes back. Amen. Oh, and John said, if you love the world, the love of the Father is not in you. We are to be in this world, but we're not to be of it. If the world can't see any difference in us, then in them we ain't saved. Amen. 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 Love not the world. Amen. Don't love this world's system, this world's ways. Don't fall in love with it. Verse number 16, 1 John 2:16. For all that is in the what? World. All that is in the world. This is it. This is all that's in the world now. The lust of the flesh. That's it. Lust of the eyes. The pride of life. And listen, he says, it's not of the Father, but it's of the world. Amen. Oh, John said that the world and its lust will all pass away. Yes, they will. The world and the lust of the flesh. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life, all these things will pass away. But he that does the will of the Father will abide forever. Amen. There was a wealthy businessman in the state of Texas, and he had this giant property, and he had a big long driveway that went up a hill into his three-car garage, I believe it was. And along that driveway, there was a beautiful flower bed that had just the most beautiful flowers. And there was a pastor that lived next door to him. He didn't live in a mansion. He just lived in a regular house just out on his land out there. Well, this pastor would drive by, and he saw his neighbor out there that had all this money, and he's on his hands and knees. It's Sunday morning, and the pastor drives by and said, "Hey, you know, Bill, why don't you come on to church today?" Oh, Bill said, "Oh, pastor, I'm sorry. I'm just too busy. If I don't get these flower beds cleaned out, and it's going to be overgrown by next week. I just don't got time, and I'm just not really religious." That's what the man said. Well, a couple of months later, that rich man named Bill died of a massive heart attack. It wasn't 2 months later that Bill's wife and a new man were out pulling weeds in this old man's flower bed. What are you trying to say, Pastor? I'm trying to say everything that man had attained in this world passed away for him. Yes, it did. The lust of the flesh, lust of the eyes, the pride of life, all of it means absolutely nothing. Amen. I like what the old people used to say when I was growing up. There ain't no U-Hauls allowed in heaven. Amen. When you die, everything you have will be left here for the Antichrist one day. Amen. Oh, I'm telling you, church, we've got to walk in the light. Amen. We've got to walk with Jesus. Don't fall in love with this world. All this world is temporal. Amen. Oh, but we've got to be remembering we ain't in this world. We may be in this world. We're not to be of this world. We are headed to a land called heaven. Heaven is eternal. Amen. My money, my house, my car, my truck, oh, they will all pass away one day. But the eternal things that I've done here on this earth, they will last forever. Amen. Don't fall in love with the temporal. Don't fall in love with this world. It's all going to pass away. Verse number 17 now. This will be the last verse for tonight. We'll finish this chapter next week. Verse number 17, listen. And the world passeth away. The world's system. The world passeth away. And the lust thereof. But, I like that word, but, he that doth the will of God abideth forever. Amen. Hallelujah. If the Lord tarries, what do you mean he tarries? If the Lord decides not to come for the next 100 years, which I really don't think he's going to hold off that long. He said, when you see these things, hallelujah, and we've been seeing these things, amen. But if the Lord decided to tarry, amen. If he decided to, 100 years from now, most of our homes will have been destroyed. Amen. My house was built in the 1950s. And if I hadn't ever touched one thing to it, and if anybody that lived there before me hadn't ever done one thing to it, it had probably already fallen down by now. Amen. Brother Randy and Sister Mary, God just blessed them. Just bought a new house. Praise God. But 100 years from now, That house is so beautiful. May look like a house just right across the street. Well, I'm telling you why? Because everything in this world is temporal. Our car, they're temporal. Well, I knew of a man one time, and he bought a 2000. It was way back then. It was probably he bought a 2005 truck. Well, 2006 came out. He was so covetous, he could not have that 2005. He had to have a 2006. Amen. Oh, but here we are. Oh, 11 years later, and now he's got to have something else. I'm telling you why. Because these things are just temporal. They all pass away. Oh, but he that does the will of God will abide forever. Can you lift your hand up unto the Lord tonight and say, Lord, let me not be so focused on right here and right now, but let me put my treasures up in heaven. Let me think eternally. Let me think about the law that can be saved and saved eternally. Let me think about my family that can be touched by God and live eternally in that land called heaven. Let me give unto the work of God that the gospel of Jesus can go forth into all the world. Oh, I'm telling you, we've got to get our thinking straight. Quit thinking about right here, right now, and think about eternity. Can you say amen? Hallelujah. This time I ask Sister Brandon, she come to the piano. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah.